Hi everyone, my name is Melissa Bondi from CTN Ann Arbor. Hopefully everyone can see my screen. I've got this wonderful PowerPoint. Everyone loves PowerPoint. So I'll go over these with everyone and then Q&A, like Sarah mentioned. So I will try not to bore anyone, but try and get through the good stuff, our services and everything that CTN has to offer the citizens of the wonderful city of Ann Arbor. So again, Melissa Bondi, I'm the Assistant Manager, Community Relations, Community Engagement. I do a little bit of everything. I've been in this medium now for 20 years, but I've been at CTN for 10. So I just hit my 10, and it's been pretty cool. It's been, you know, COVID changed a lot of things, but we've got a wonderful studio here in Ann Arbor we'll talk about. But yeah, so I might mention throughout, we are a PEG station. So that stands for Public Education and Government. So there's many stations like ours around the country, around the state that may just be a P, may just be an E, may just be a G, but we are fortunate enough to be all public education and government. So we operate and program four cable channels. If you have Comcast here in Ann Arbor, so these are part of our core services that we've got. We provide coverage of all of the city meetings for the city of Ann Arbor. And we promote hundreds of nonprofits through our services, event coverage, and countless nonprofits, not just from Ann Arbor, Washtenaw, but from really all over. We've interviewed nonprofits from all over the country, really, usually having, you know, a tie or a service having to do with, you know, Washtenaw County. We provide local election coverage. So election years are really big for us and all the making sure we get all of the information out through our constituents and our programming. So election years are very busy for us. Public media production facilities. So that's our studios. We'll talk about that in a little bit. And then we offer the free workshops, free media production workshops to our residents here in Ann Arbor. Like I mentioned, we're in Comcast Xfinity here in Ann Arbor. So we've got our four channels. We've got the 16, 17, 18, and 19. Each of them have a little bit of different demographic programming. So channel 17, you might hear me refer to that one as the public access channel. So that's always been your channel, the public's channel. So we don't pre-screen or gatekeep or do anything with channel 17. That is your channel. So if you've got something you would like to put on Channel 17, it can be a wedding video, it can be a 10-second promo video that you've done for something, it can be something with your phone, as long as it meets the criteria as far as filling out the proper paperwork and making sure it's, you know, submitted to us properly digitally or on DVD, you can put almost anything you'd like without breaking any FCC regulations on Channel 17. Channel 16 is city meetings and our CTN's programs. So that's like all of the programs that our producers and part-timers work on. So we've got our core shows that we work on and our series that we work on here. And we will put that on typically on 16, but a couple of the shows like the Let's Watch with the Ann Arbor Film Festival, that one goes on 18. So that's just the educational channel. So that's where we're going to get our programming from the many, many educational institutions from all over, not just Michigan, but we've got streams coming from UCTV in California. So we have, if there's any educational programming content that, you know, you would want to put on or that we feel would be better suited on 18, we will put it on that channel. But typically most of the public shows go on 17. And then channel 19 is our community bulletin board. So that's our 24/7 bulletin board. We'll talk about that in a little bit too, how you can submit if you've got an event or something you would like to promote. We will put that up on our bulletin board to run and folks can see that in between programming as well on the other channels, but 24/7 on channel 19. We're also on channel 99 on AT&T. So for those folks that have AT&T, if you navigate to channel 99, you're going to see the same programs as on Comcast channel 16. So the CTN originally produced programs as well as our city meeting. So you don't have cable, you cut the cord, you just, you know, use streaming services, or maybe you don't watch TV that much, but you may watch online. So we have the option for folks from all over, anywhere in the world, to watch CTN on our live stream, on our website, on our video on demand, on our website as well, and on our YouTube channel, which I refer to as our fifth channel. So we've got 16, 17, 18, and 19, and then our YouTube channel. So it's one of our more popular ways that we stream our live meetings, put all of the CTN programs on our YouTube. And again, we can also track views and analytics from YouTube. So that's very helpful in that regard. And we also are on an app. So that app is called the Cablecast app. And it can be found on Roku, the Apple TV, Amazon Fire. I don't live in Ann Arbor. So a lot of times if I'm checking on the channels, I will do that via our website or on the app. And the beauty of that is that all of our programs in these ways of viewing are in HD. And if you know on cable, unfortunately right now, they are not in HD. Nonetheless, though, there's still great content and great programming, but you're able to watch it in HD if you're watching it at any of these streaming options. So real quick, I'd just like to mention this about our funding. So CTN is funded through franchise fees. So it's not tax, not your taxes that people pay. It is a tax on your cable bill. So it is a franchise fee and a PEG fee. And so what happens is the cable provider pays the city a fee to put their cables and the use of rights away on the sidewalks. So if they're running their cables through the city, they're going to pay for that usage. So fortunately, the city of Ann Arbor takes that fee money and they put that toward CTN. So that's, they've got we get a 5% as well as a 2% PEG fee. So that's how we get our annual funding every year. And I can say, you know, over the years, as people do cut the cord or they don't want cable or, you know, they've gone other streaming services and other ways to view TV or their favorite programs or channels, you know, we do know that, you know, funding has decreased over the years. So we nationally, I mean, everyone keeps an eye on that pretty closely, but I can tell you that, you know, CTN is still we're still here, we're still thriving. We've got a wonderful community and city that supports us, as well as all of our, you know, our members, our clients, our viewers. So by no means are we, you know, just on edge yet. But that's, you know, obviously that is not a secret that, you know, folks are cutting the cord. And when people do that, it does affect our overall budget. Going into viewership. So a lot of folks are like, you know, who watches? How do you watch? Who do you know that watches? And how many people watch? And where is it shown? So CTN is, you know, fortunately, we're able to reach Ann Arbor, the city of Ann Arbor. Our channels reach Ypsilanti Township, parts of Scio, parts of Pittsfield. So our channels and the penetration rate does, you know, reach a good amount of folks in their and households and businesses. However, we do know that majority of the, I would say, people are watching online. So, you know, it's that balance of, well, you know, we like to promote things online as well as on our channels. And there's always, you know, I like to say there's always something about seeing yourself or someone you know, or, you know, watching something on TV just has a different oomph to it as opposed to watching it online. So there's something to be said for watching something on TV or watching yourself or someone you know. It's kind of fun in that regard. But again, you know, we don't have ratings. We never have. PEG channels can't afford that, and they don't have anything. You know, we're not commercial. So a lot of those tracking, the Nielsen's in that are for Arbitron. They're for tracking for commercial. You know, people want to know, you know, when their money is spent and who's watching, and they want to get that type of data. And that's not what PEG television is. So we're not commercial. So basically, you know, it's the free speech. It's, you know, what do you have something to say? We're going to put, you know, come say it at CTN or put it on or produce a show, or, you know, we make it so that folks can use our facility without, you know, that many limitations and without any type of censorship. So yeah, that's the number one of the number one questions we get is who watches. So I can tell you back in the day where I used to work, honestly, I was on TV more, I was hosting more and did more than I do here. So, you know, regular shows and whatnot, and people would literally recognize me just from being at the grocery store. Or I remember one time at church, people would say, oh, aren't you the girl that's on TV? So that was a long time ago. So I don't hear that as often. I don't know if people say that as much because maybe not as many people are watching on TV. We don't want that to be the case, but, you know, in reality, we have to kind of, you know, understand that more people, you know, watch TV streaming and watching on video on demand or later online. So that's kind of what we say when it comes to viewership. So meeting coverage, yes, we cover over 200 meetings a year. Our staff does, they do a fantastic job. We have, I think it's 20 now, 20 meetings that we cover for the city of Ann Arbor. We stream them, we put them on video on demand, and as well as we put them on our YouTube channel that stream live. So there'll be times where if the website or YouTube may be down, or the channel may be down, or we have power outages. A lot of times, if you can't watch it on cable, people will turn to a YouTube channel. Or if they're not at home, you know, you'll be able to watch it, you know, on your mobile device if you need to catch or want to watch a meeting. So we also cover special meetings. There have been numerous ones over the years. Police task force, solid waste advisory, any special sessions that maybe a committee or a commission asks us to cover. We also play back on our channels the Washtenaw County Board of Commissioners meeting, the DDA meetings, the AAATA meetings. All of those folks, I believe some of them put them on their own website as well as put them possibly, I think, on their, you know, streaming services, but we get them as well. So fortunately, we can play back and folks will have a variety of ways to watch these. And as well, I should also mention the Ann Arbor Public Schools Board of Education meetings. Those are one of our most popular, next to planning and city council. I can tell you those ones get the most hits. So yeah, we've got a great relationship with the schools. Make sure that we cover all of the Board of Education meetings monthly. So we are part of, a little bit about us, we're part of the communications department. So I call us the branch of the communications department. We have our own studio on Industrial Drive at Eisenhower and Industrial. We've got 8 full-time staff, which includes management, producers, a programmer, and our media trainer. We have about 3 to 4 temporary part-time staff that rotate through the year. So they're on 9-month rotations. And as well, we have a seasonal internship program. So I'm getting ready to bring on my spring summer interns. We had a little lull there, 2020, 2021, but we are starting to get that back up with college, mostly college students, a couple of high school. But we also have a program with the Ann Arbor Public Schools. It's called the CR program. It's called the Community Resource Program. And we, I think over a course of a year, we have 2 to 4 students that do, that work with our media trainer. So they're part of that program, which is separate from the internship program. So I had mentioned the CTN produced, or we call them original programs. So these are our CTN produced programs that we as staff produce. Some of them are weekly, monthly, quarterly. So it just depends. It depends on what the content is. So we have we have hosts in-house. We've got freelance hosts. We've got hosts, for example, our CTN Sports. So they're very active. Actually, they have their own Twitter page. Very popular CTN Sports. We cover certain sports in the spring, the winter, and the fall for Ann Arbor Public Schools. and their certain sports, football, basketball, volleyball. So that's another pretty popular program that programs that we get. I can tell you some of our popular ones. That's one of them. But Ann Arbor Inclusive, Adventures in Parenthood, talk about all the parenting, FYI, our weekly magazine program, Green Room. We work with Washtenaw County. In fact, we're doing a little bit of rebranding with that show. Let's Watch with the Ann Arbor Film Festival. If you don't know, that's going on right now. So we've got a partnership with the film festival. We interview up to the festival. We interview filmmakers from all over the country, actually all over the world, I believe. And we've got senior moments. We talk about that senior programming, senior content, senior news. We work with the senior centers, Soapbox, and we'll talk more about that, is the show that we create for you. So folks, Ann Arbor residents, nonprofits can come on Soapbox, talk for 5 minutes about anything you'd like to talk about once a month. And that is our way of, you know, you want to talk about something, you don't have time to produce your own show, you don't want to take the classes, but you want to talk and get something out, promote something, a business, you know, that's, shouldn't say a business, but something along the lines of a professional. One of our, a good one to bring up would be the chiropractor. So she would come on and talk about chiropractic care. She's a chiropractor and she's here in Ann Arbor, but she just simply would give tips on, you know, posture and back pain and kind of alleviating things. And she'd come on for five minutes and talk about anything chiropractic care. So we also got War Talk, if you haven't seen that. So that's where our host talks to the different council members in their ward. That's a monthly show, kind of what's going on, a little Q&A, talking head. So we've got all these different programs along with all the special programs that we put in and are asked to produce, or we find that we feel it would be, you know, make for great programming and a great show throughout the year. This is some of the additional programs and partnerships. I mentioned a couple. So we do our Santa live show every year. So that's a big one with the kids. We bring in Santa. That went virtual the last couple of years. So Santa calls in from the North Pole and we bring in kids. So this is a way that kids could talk with Santa without having to go in person, but they still wanted to Zoom in with them. It's a super fun show. And that's one of our more popular ones. Candidate Comment, which I mentioned in the election years, pretty popular. We also partner with the League of Women Voters for all of their election coverage. The Ann Arbor Art Fair, how can we forget that? We've been down there for 20 some years. This last year, we changed it up a little bit and we did more of a man on the street. And that was super fun. We interviewed fairgoers and we interviewed folks that were the artists that were down there, as opposed to having them come to our booth. So that was really enjoyable this past summer. And then we have our media camp. So we're pretty busy with that. Every summer, the last few summers, they've asked us, the Ann Arbor Rec and Ed asked us if we host a media camp for kids ages, I believe, 10 to 12. And they come in for, we've got two camps during the summer, and the kids will come in and learn more about, you know, shooting video out in the field. And then we bring them back in and they learn how to edit it and put something together for the end of the week. And then as well, we covered the Ann Arbor Public Schools High School commencement. We've been doing that for umpteen years. We go out, we do the five schools. And as well, I mentioned that Ann Arbor Public Schools, a community resource program. So these are some of the long-standing partnerships that we've had. We've had other ones that come and go every other year, just kind of depends. But these are the more longer standing ones. And this is, I mentioned Channel 19, our electronic bulletin board. So this is for, if you've got, a lot of times I'll grab things off Twitter or social media. If you put out a flyer or a meme or something out in the social media world, we want you to send it to us as well. So if not a garage sale, but it's like sometimes we don't promote anything selling or business-wise in that regard. If there's an event at a business and it's a not-for-profit, it's a charity, it's a fundraiser, something like that, of course we would. But if it's a business looking to promote, you know, a sale or something like that, it's non-commercial. So it's pretty easy. We have a form on our website that you can find, EBB, and it's a electronic bulletin board, and you can fill that out online. It's a, it gets sent right to me. And then I, or you can send me the info via email and I can put something together. If you send a logo or an infographic, or it can just be, you know, maybe I'll even find something if it's something maybe weather related, put, you know, clouds or make it cutesy or whatever it is to make it more, you know, enjoyable, not so, you know, boring to look at. So I'll jazz it up a little bit the best that we can. But yeah, folks definitely need to take care or take advantage of the EBB. And if you haven't seen it, you can log in again at any time 19 and watch it 24/7. So residency requirements. So we do have requirements in regard to our two services. So folks that want to come in and take workshops and learn media, and then folks who maybe want to turn something in a channel, like I mentioned, onto channel 17. So two things. So residency is City of Ann Arbor, so city proper, or a nonprofit. And the nonprofit, we do require a letter to be sent in. We keep that on file for a year, stating that if you're from, you know, X, Y, and Z, and folks from your organization are going to be taking workshops, or they need to, you know, they'd like to borrow equipment that we've got to work on something for the organization itself, then you're able to do so. Residency, again, a little different in regard to, we do check residency, make sure you're from Ann Arbor, and then you'll be able and eligible to take our workshop. We have had different, and we've had stipulations over the years, but for the most part, it is for Ann Arbor residents, the city. So some folks will live in Scio Township, and they'll say, well, my, you know, mailing address is Ann Arbor. And I said, well, you know, we look it up. You can look it up. We have it on our website as far as looking up your eligibility. But, you know, if you're, unfortunately, if you're in Scio or Pittsfield and you get our channels, we get that too. Like, well, we can see CTN. Unfortunately, it's per our policy, it is for Ann Arbor residents to take our workshops, to use our facility. And I should mention too, using our facility is also if you just wanted to use the space as well. So maybe you need a conference room, or you do need a studio, or maybe you just need a certain lighting. So that's always an option too, as opposed to using all of our equipment and taking full on workshops. But you may need something at our facility. That is an option as well. So the studio, so that's our, everyone, you know, I got a TV studio. So unfortunately, I should mention, we don't rent our studio. We've got a lot of questions about renting. We don't rent out our facility. A lot of it has to do, a lot of it is with staffing, time. You know, we're not a huge production facility like that, where we are, you know, looking to do commercial productions, or looking to, you know, supplement any type of budgetary issues. It is simply, this is for our community. This is for our residents. These are our services that we provide. And we've got the main studio, the hotline studio, and we've got a lot of production equipment in regards to cameras, mics, green screens. We've got GoPros, DSLR, tripods, lights, ring lights, anything that you may, we found, definitely found during the shutdown, because we were shut down for quite a while. But we wanted to make sure that folks could still get the equipment. So we did invest a little bit more, so because we found that people were doing more productions at home, right? So they couldn't use the studio anymore. They couldn't use their editing bays. So they, you know, we were able to get to check out laptops and green screens, microphones, lights, if you've already got most, a lot of folks, you know, invested in that equipment, but they maybe didn't get everything. So we were able to kind of supplement with our equipment for folks who were doing things at home and, you know, still creating programming and content. It was for their YouTube channel. And if you're doing something for your YouTube channel, we always say, hey, why don't you put it on CTN as well? So we've got audio booth. So if you need to just maybe record a voiceover in our booth for a project that you're working on, whether it's at CTN or at home, we've got that option, as well as our editing software. So we've got our MacBook Pros. We teach folks on Final Cut Pro. We've got Motion Compressor, and our staff, most of our production staff, I should say most, probably half, use the Avid software. So that's another software that's been around a long time for editing video. But for the most part, we teach folks on Final Cut. And that's what we've invested in for quite a few years now. And we upgrade and when Final Cut brings out, you know, their upgrades and their next, the next, you know, 10.10 or whatever it is, we will upgrade with that and then teach folks on any of the new, anything new that has to do, we'll train ourselves and then train our clients. So the workshops, the basic workshops that we offer are remote, our studio, our hotline, and our editing. And I can tell you over the last 3 years, the use and request for the studio has definitely gone down because it does take a lot of manpower to do a studio production. So it's not just coming in with, you know, two people. It's three cameras. You've got possibly a teleprompter. You've got audio. How many people are you putting, you know, on the floor? Do you have a floor director? Do you have, you know, a director, of course. So a lot of times we will start off, right? You do baby steps and you'll start with your hotline studio. And folks can actually go in there and produce a show on their own. So that's kind of amazing. So right now that photo below is one of our workshops taking place. I think that was five people in there, six people. But for the most part, over the last 3 years since 2020, we have gone a more one-on-one training. So we have been able to kind of work with folks, you know, what they want to learn, as opposed to sitting in a studio with eight people that they don't know and you know, kind of going like, it was kind of old school. And we found that working one-on-one with our clients has been amazing. And they're getting that time with our trainer to kind of take the next steps of their production. Because maybe you're not all on the same page. They're, you know, if you're working in a workshop like this, where, you know, everyone's got, you know, different ideas, they want to do this, but this way you can work with our trainer one-on-one and maybe, you know, expedite your production or your idea or something that you're thinking about making, you know, turn to television versus, you know, having to wait one night a week for 6 weeks. So we've just found that route we've gone has been pretty successful. As well as editing. So maybe you're not interested in a studio, but you shoot video at home, but you want to learn more about putting that all that video you shot. What the heck do I do with it? Well, we're going to teach you how to put it together. So maybe, you know, that's what you want to learn is just simply editing, or you've got, you know, your cell phone video or, you know, your whatever, you know, video you've got and you want to learn how to put it together. It doesn't have to be something shot from a, you know, $10,000 camera. It can be something you've done with our smartphones or our devices. So, and as well, we get a lot of folks who have experience. So, and they're like, well, I've already done this and do I have to sit through this? And no, you don't. So there's an option for testing out. And we've done a lot with that lately. It's been pretty successful too. So Jamie, our trainer, will go over as far as testing out and you know, you be able to expedite your project that way by testing out. But some folks just want to get a refresher or they find it just simply interesting. It just kind of depends on what everyone's timeline is. So once you take a workshop or you become involved at CTN, we consider you a public access producer, right? So you're a public access community producer. And you've got a responsibility at this point. So if you're going to be putting out content, we want to make sure that content is, you know, coincides with, you know, our policies and procedures, as well as anything from the FCC guidelines. But like I said earlier, we don't pre-screen or pre-censor or gatekeep any of your content. So if you've got something and it's questionable and you'd like to ask us about it, maybe, you know, it's language or something you're like, I don't know about this. So of course we would help you. We would watch it if you want us to watch it, but you're not going to turn it in and we're going to watch it and say, nope, can't play that. Nothing of the sort. That's just simply an unethical thing to do in public access TV. So, but if there's any issues, if you turn something in and we noticed, you know, when we're, you know, putting into the schedule that, you know, the audio is too low or, you know, something technical is wrong, then we're going to let you know. But as far as watching it, we don't. So there, again, there's no commercial content in PEG television. There is that fine line. you know, talking about a website, or again, a professional in their field, talking about, you know, you're a realtor and you want to talk about, you know, real estate is so hot right now. And this is the, you know, this is how folks are redoing their bathrooms and this is what's trending. Of course, you know, you're an expert in your field. You just have to be careful with a lot of the language. With the language, if there's any call to actions, is where we may get involved and let you know, you can't really do that. So you might need to reword that or rethink that. Because if we get a call, you're going to get a call. So that's something as far as your program, you're signing a form that says you're taking responsibility for it all. CTN is not. So that's where that comes into play. And over the years, there's been calls. So we just ask again, we would go over all of the stuff once, you know, you're ready or you've already got something, right? Maybe you have something and you want to turn it in. We can then, you know, go over the policies and procedures with you then, as opposed to you, you know, having to go through our workshops and go through that. So that's what I mean as far as the services, it's workshops, or do you want to use the channel because you've already got something you'd like to submit? Those are kind of the two routes. And then again, underwriting. In fact, I did underwriting is, you know, the goods or services. Someone's provided something for you on the show. Maybe the local pizza, you know, local pizza place down the road provided lunch for all, you know, your producer, and they provided lunch for all of your staff that worked on the show that you produced for, you know, 4 hours, and you want to give them credit. So of course you can do that. Maybe someone provided something on the set. A set piece or your hair and makeup. For a lot of times talent will, you know, say, and you know, my makeup is provided by. So that's certainly something that you can do. We just ask that you disclose it on your form, and all should be set there, but I'm happy to answer any questions about that. Again, submitting your videos is what I mentioned. So residents, there is a form, it's an application for presentation. It's a form that's on our website. And you have something you right now, it's on your YouTube channel, and you're like, you know, I'd really like to go on CTN. It's another avenue for marketing, you know, your content, you put on social media, you put on YouTube, you put on CTN. So again, there's that application that you'll fill out and get sent right to us, electronic. And then you would also, at the same time, send that program to us and that file, preferably about the same time. And then that would get to us as well. And they come in together. Typically, Google Drive is probably the most popular way, but there are other, you know, file sharing programs out there, and Dropbox is another one that folks will use. So again, you can put that out there or submit that, the application, the file, and then our programmer will reach out to you in regards to maybe you want a time slot or when will this be on, and he's very good at communication in that regard. So again, the first step though is to make sure you're a resident. We get you in our database. And then from there, you kind of have, you're like, okay, now this is what I want to do next. So a few minor steps before that, but real, nothing too crazy. A little bit, so I put in our CTN Ann Arbor. So again, we're on Facebook, Twitter, and our YouTube channel. So I like to share all of our programming that goes out. We retweet stuff from the city, different entities and organizations within Washtenaw County. So I'll do that. If I should mention on our YouTube channel, so the public channel 17, so your programs, we don't put that on our YouTube channel. We let folks use their content and push it out how they prefer social media wise, but it is on our, you know, streams on our website. If people want to go, you know, watch, you know, someone wants to watch channel 17 at home, on the web, they're able, or home, but on the web, they're able to watch it, channel 17 on the web as well as on the channel. But there, we don't put the public's programs on the CTN YouTube channel. I won't confuse anyone there. And these are our contact info. So myself, Jamie, who is our instructor, our multimedia instructor, Craig, our programmer, he's been there 20 plus years. And then again, on our website, you can subscribe to CTN updates, and I send out a weekly channel premieres. That's our live meetings and all of our premieres that go out every week. You can sign up on our website that way. And as well, you can join the public access Facebook group. There's a group on there and it is private. There's a couple of us admins, and we will let you in once you become a member. And as well, I should also mention there is you can subscribe to our updates for premieres, and then there's also another option to sign up for updates on just the public access portion of, you know, any type of updates there as well. So it's a little separate from the CTN update. There's two, and I'll probably make that a little more clear. But it's on our website, and it's hosted by Gov Delivery. If some of you folks are familiar with that, it's this city's listserv. So, and I see a question. Okay, so which of the CTN channels are available using the Apple TV Cablecast app? All of them, actually. So yeah, if you go into the Cablecast app and you scroll down, you'll see the seat, I believe. It'll be all sorts of municipalities within the Detroit metro, or no, all of Michigan, that use Tightrope. It's called Tightrope, and they host this app, and that's our who we use for our playback system, and they have an app. So that was part of the package, and it's all four of our channels. So you can click each one, and they're labeled, so you'll be able to watch which one you would want to view. And are the classes and workshop offered on a regular basis? So, good question. Yes. Actually, the first step to do a class is to take the preview. I should probably mention that's kind of important. It's kind of similar to what this is right now, actually. So this is an extended preview. So the first thing to do is to take a preview. So if you weren't doing the Citizens Academy tonight, you'd contact me or Jamie, and I would say, let's set up a preview. And I kind of go over all of this, not as much detail, but more detail on classes and workshops. And then from there, I would then turn you over to Jamie or myself, and then you would schedule a tour or a call with Jamie would be the next step. And then she would then start going over, you know, what your goals are at CTN. What would you like to learn or produce? Maybe you just want to come take a tour. And that's always an option too. Maybe you just want to take a tour. So someone said, we primarily use an antenna for live TV. Why does CTN not have a channel offered that way? Ah, yes. So no, that has come up over the year. We're cable. So we're not broadcast. And I think broadcast is, you know, in the air versus cable in the ground. So, but that has come up before about getting a antenna and doing that. I think our cable commission explored that not too long ago. It was probably about four or five years ago. And there was a lot of, there's some FCC regulations, guidelines. It wasn't as easy, I think, as the commissioners who were kind of proposing it, because they used an antenna as well. Unfortunately, it was just, there was a lot to applying, I believe, for that license to be able to do that. So we didn't explore it because I think that wasn't something the commission felt that they wanted to explore at that time. I think this is really when we were kind of video on demand, YouTube, online streaming was kind of taking off, or I would say it exponentially since I started 10 years ago. There was no online, I don't even think there was online viewing of our channels then. Oh my gosh, I have to go back and look at that. It wasn't too long after, but yeah, there was, but that was explored, definitely. There's just a lot of policy and licensing and regulations to do so. That answer your question. Do you rotate content on channel 17 or are things shown only once? Oh, no. Not, definitely not. So if you've turned something in to us and you said you're guaranteed, so per our procedures, you're guaranteed two times that your show will be shown. Now, if you said, you know, you can play this indefinitely, oh, we're keeping it indefinitely, most likely. Or if you maybe there's a pull date or a kill date, you would let us know on the form. Or if you said, you know what, maybe you can play it's something that's an annual, maybe something annually and an event. And you're like, can you play this maybe every January? Our programmer is so good, he will remember that, even though he's worked with, you know, thousands of programs over the years. So most definitely not. You're guaranteed twice, but if you would like it to run more, is all you have to ask, as well as the option of having time slots. So that's even better. right? So you can actually tell folks I've got a time slot. So if you produce a show and it has, you know, up to, I think it's, you have to have four on file. If you have four shows and you've turned them in, you're now eligible to have a time slot. So if you're like, you know what, I want every Wednesday at 9, you're then eligible to get sold, as long as someone else doesn't have it. But that's also an option too for our folks who are regularly produced program, who produce, you know, programs that are on the regular. They can have a slot, that way they can promote to their viewers. We can promote in our, you know, in our marketing, things that go out on our EVB will promote shows. So that way, it, you know, you can, you're even cool enough to say that you have your own time slot. So that's always a super fun perk in regards to some of our programming. So no more questions. Okay, I hope I answered everything for everyone. So yeah, I think the next step, if you are interested in CTN, to contact me or Jamie. You've already kind of taken the preview, so I won't make you sit through this again. But if you have an idea, you can certainly email us and I will kind of, you know, I'll direct you in, you know, which way we suggest for, you know, whatever it is that you're looking to create or want to turn in.
Thank you so much, Melissa. We really appreciate having you today.
Awesome. Yes, thank you. Always fun.
Awesome. Thank you. All righty. Everybody say bye to Melissa. Now we will be hearing from Rosie and Becky. Rosie is a part of Greenbelt and Becky is a part of NAP. And I'm just going to take a second to make them co-hosts. All righty. And the floor is yours, Rosie and Becky.
Great. Thank you, Sarah. I'm going to get this started here. So Becky and I will each do a half hour presentation. I will talk about the Greenbelt program and Becky will talk about the Natural Areas program. So you see my screen. Yes, good. Okay. So my name is Rosie. I am the Land Acquisition Supervisor for the City of Ann Arbor Parks and Recreation Services. I'll be talking today about part of the Open Space and Parkland Preservation Program, all of which uses real estate tools to protect land for conservation and or recreation purposes. The program has two branches, in-city parkland acquisition and the one I'll be telling you about today, the Greenbelt program. To really capture the function and significance of the Ann Arbor Greenbelt program, we have to start zoomed out to our state and regional contexts. The state of Michigan, where we are, is the Great Lakes state. The land use and environment of Michigan directly affects the health of this collection of 20% of the Earth's surface freshwater. So our, you know, our land use and land preservation is critical to the health of those lakes and our drinking water. Michigan also has the second most diverse agricultural economy in the United States, the first being California. 50% of the state's population, however, resides here in Southeast Michigan in just about 6% of its total, of the state's total land base. Historical planning documents from a long time ago envision Southeast Michigan like this picture, with an emerald arc of forest and farms surrounding Metro Detroit. The folks planning at the time saw Detroit expanding and wanted to protect its surrounding area before it became too late. That vision, that Emerald Arc vision, was one of many ideas to inform the city's discussion, the city of Ann Arbor's discussion, on what it wanted its area to look like, Ann Arbor and its surroundings. So leading up to 2003, early 2000, city voters put together their own vision. That vision was of a city surrounded by the farmland that characterizes our rural and agricultural heritage and sources the local food economy. That vision was of green infrastructure upstream of the Huron River, safeguarding our source water, and a vision of open space, recreational opportunities, diverse habitats, biodiversity surrounding the city, preserved forever. That's a common theme of the Greenbelt, perpetuity and talking about forever. So that vision was put in front of city voters in November 2003 in the form of the Open Space and Parkland Preservation Millage, which passed with 67% of the vote. The associated ordinance, chapter 42, if you want to read it, and the program created this green belt boundary around the city, drawn here in its current iteration, within which city tax money would be used to preserve land in its natural or agricultural state. So that's the city of Ann Arbor residents taxing themselves to protect land outside of the city. At the municipal level, the Greenbelt doing this, what the citizens chose to do, is rare. This is a rare program. Very few cities in the country work to protect land outside of their administrative area. The only one that I really know of is Lexington, Kentucky. It's really special. Washtenaw County, where we sit, is also unusual and lucky in the many preservation programs operating here in addition to the Greenbelt. So we are not alone. Land preservation at local and regional levels, i.e. not the National Park Service, really got going the second half of the 20th century, but mostly by nonprofit land trusts. So we have two overlapping land trusts with the Greenbelt area, which are Southeast Michigan Land Conservancy and Legacy Land Conservancy. We work frequently with them, especially Legacy. The Greenbelt and its Open Space and Parkland Preservation Millage Initiative was part of a surge of local government-run preservation programs and taxes in the early 2000s, starting with the Washtenaw County Parks and Recreation Commission's Natural Areas Preservation Program. Governments are always long-winded. Followed by the Ann Arbor Greenbelt in 2003, as well as Ann Arbor Township's own land preservation millage. And then Scio Township and Webster Township, all of these townships overlap with the Greenbelt area, followed in quick succession with their own land preservation millages. So all of these have similar goals, slightly different particular land priorities, but all of these overlap, and we are all close colleagues, and we frequently collaborate and share funds to get land protected. More recently, at the end of this timeline here, a few other townships have passed their own millages, notably for the Greenbelt, Northfield Township, as that is in the Greenbelt. So that suggests that we will work with them even more and get more land protected in that area. So back to the millage that the city passed in 2003, the Open Space and Parkland Preservation Millage that funds this work is a 30-year millage. It was bonded for upfront, so there was money to work with right out the gate, and we still collect money every year. So 30 years means it is now 2023. We are 20 years in, two-thirds of the way there, got 10 years more. As I described in the very beginning of this presentation, there are two branches to this millage and the program. And thus two buckets into which this millage revenue is split: parkland acquisition inside the city and Greenbelt land acquisition outside of the city. Two-thirds goes to the Greenbelt. These two funds are overseen by different commissions, the Park Advisory Commission for parkland and the Greenbelt Advisory Commission for Greenbelt land. Greenbelt funds can be used towards conservation of privately owned lands and towards establishing public recreation areas. We are most familiar, or generally people are most familiar with buying land, turning it into parks, nature preserves, and We do that too. The Greenbelt focuses on the former, tends to focus on private development rights, but we partner frequently with Scioto Township and especially Washtenaw County Parks to fund their purchase of nature preserves. So the most recent example of this is exciting. It was funding of the county parks addition to their Northfield Woods Preserve. So predictably in Northfield Township. So the original preserve that they already owned is just out of the frame of this picture to the south down on Joy Road. But this 220-acre addition to that preserve that we're looking at here, that's sort of shaded in brown in the bottom corner. This is right off US 23 on Northfield Church Road. That's the road to the south. Territorial is to the north. This was a large, expensive purchase. So County Parks asked the Greenbelt if we would contribute a portion of the acquisition costs. GAC, the Greenbelt Advisory Commission, and City Council approved that request, and County Parks closed on that piece of land this past November, adding 220 acres. Its major conservation value is all of that contiguous forest land and just the fact that it's so large, so close to the city. There aren't any trails there yet, but it will be open to the public and actively stewarded. The benefit to city residents here and the purposes of the Greenbelt that this fulfills is public recreation, water health. This piece of land is full of wetlands, wet forested areas, scenic value, and continued carbon storage and sequestration with all of that forest and soil being undisturbed. And before I move on here, I want you to take note of the farm field adjacent to that preserve to the northeast, in the northeast corner of that little circle, because that piece of farm will come up again later. The purchase of development rights, moving away from public recreation area and back to the typical thing that we do. The purchase of development rights, also called conservation easements, on private land is a bit more unique. This is designed to keep land in private hands, owned privately, not by the government, maintained in its current natural or agricultural condition in perpetuity. The term purchase of development rights is the action taken and the legal document recorded in the chain of title of the land. Is the conservation easement or conservation easement deed. You'll hear people use those two terms interchangeably. I like to focus on conservation easement because it better conveys the full function of the action, which is to conserve soil and trees and whatever is on the particular piece of property that's important. Financially, easements are more cost-effective than purchasing land outright because the cost of a conservation easement is only a partial value of the property. A common analogy used to describe one's rights to a property that they own is the bundle of sticks analogy. When you own land, you own multiple rights to that land or multiple sticks to that property. You own the right to develop it, the right to enjoy it, the right to access it, the right to sell it to whomever you want. Before I talk about development rights, a common right that other people have to your land is often utility companies. They have some sort of right to access your land to maintain their utilities or to put a utility there at all. By purchasing the development rights, select rights are removed from that bundle of sticks forever. And those are the development rights. So we are buying away the ability to develop it into subdivisions, to build much of anything except in very designated areas. And doing this guarantees the preservation of the private property for as long as we have government to acknowledge legal documents and chain of title. To illustrate the cost effectiveness of conservation easements, all of this land that we work with, we get appraised. So the total fair market value of the land protected by the Greenbelt so far in its full value
if it could be developed. That fair market value is $83.6 million, and city taxpayers have only paid about a third of that. And that's because of the fact that it's easements, that we're paying only a portion of the full value of the property. It's also partially because we have so many other local programs and we all share costs. And it is also that there are great consistent federal grants available for this work that we utilize frequently. Some fun maps to illustrate the success over the years. So this map shows with some discretion, because we don't know the purchase years of all of the lands around here, actually, but this is approximately what was preserved both by easement and by publicly held as nature preserves in the year 2000. And then all of those programs came into being. And now we have that much preserved. That's what the map looks like. All of our work together for 23 years is just exploded in green. Again, conservation easements, nature preserves, parks. It just really makes an impact to see that. From our perspective, that is, this accounts for 85 acquisitions completed with Greenbelt money, totaling 7,600 acres. We recently hit that mark. The total amount in the Greenbelt, the total amount of land preserved with or without our money is just shy of 14% of the total Greenbelt area. Some more stats. Those 85 acquisitions include 68 working farms. 8 of those source food to local markets. You can find them at the Ann Arbor farmers market and other places. 7 new farmers were able to secure more affordable land through buying these farms with easements on them, which reduced the cost. And the city has secured millions in external funding support. To illustrate our conservation goals, the conservation outcomes of the easement, the Greenbelt has protected 28 miles of waterways, mostly in the Huron River watershed, which is the source water, or I'm sorry, the where the city gets its drinking water. Not all of the land in the Greenbelt is, of course, agricultural land. So we also measure the percent of available ag land that the Greenbelt has protected, and that's about 18%. Also a thing to note here, there's a big focus on agricultural land, but easements don't have to be just on farmland. They can also be on predominantly natural areas, and we do have a few like that. The Greenbelt has helped establish 11 new nature preserves, lots of acres, hiking trails, thousands of woodlands, wetlands. We've started measuring our success also in terms of carbon dioxide stored through carbon storage. And so that of the Greenbelt totals 302,000 metric tons stored, which is the equivalent of 751 million miles driven by an average vehicle. Yeah, and we're constantly, we keep looking for more ways to tap into measuring other ecosystem services of our work. So that was the program overview. I'm going to check time. Okay. And jump into some details about like what our work looks like. Like what does a conservation easement entail? What does that work look like? So there are a few steps. So the first step is landowner applies to the Greenbelt. They submit their application and staff have a discussion about their land with the landowner, typically phone call, email, a visit. So this is a total hypothetical farm I'm going to use here. Not an uncommon size, a little large for the green belt, but totally hypothetical here. So this farmer would submit their 100-acre farm, and we would have this discussion here that they want to reserve 5 acres along the road for a future home and agricultural buildings. So we draw a little box around that, and that doesn't go in the conservation easement. So the rest of the farm goes in this conservation easement. So we agree on this, and we agree on general terms of what a conservation easement is as well. There's a lot of education sometimes at this point as well. And then once we've agreed on all of that, the city orders an appraisal. Again, extremely hypothetical numbers there, not real numbers. Don't take those as fact. But they're just solid round numbers to work with. So we order an appraisal, and a conservation easement appraisal is really two appraisals. It values the land before an easement is on it, so at full developable value. So in this scenario, that's $1 million. Then the appraisal does a second appraisal, which values the land after an easement is placed on it. So what is the value of it if it can't be turned into a subdivision? And then so that's 700,000 in this example. And the difference between those two numbers is the value of the easement, what we can pay the landowner for the conservation easement. So we order that and we give that to the landowner. And if the landowner's like, that residual land value, that easement payment, $300,000 is good with me, we get that approved by council. And then we enter a purchase agreement with them. And that really gets the ball rolling. The next step, not all of these are perfectly sequential, but this is the gist of it. The next step is ordering title work. This is my favorite part personally. So this is looking at like other easements, like pipelines that are on the property, any liens, any interesting stuff in the chain of title of the land. So the example I'm using here is of a property that we own. This isn't privately held land or anything. This is a publicly owned piece of property I'm showing here. So like something that we looked at here are, you know, number 10 right of way for pipeline purposes vested in Panhandle Eastern Pipeline Company. So then we go look at those right of ways and those libers that they reference, and we check like, is it very defined? Is it a defined width? Is it just a blanket easement? Do we need to narrow it? Is it too much pipeline? Things like that, as an example. Next step, we order a phase one environmental site assessment and a survey. So the environmental site assessment looks for any contamination on the land. Most of the time there is not, but if there is, then we do more testing and the landowner has to clean up any issues found, and a survey is done too. So you can see this one, it's the same property that we own. You can see the pipelines drawn on there. So that survey is legally required and that gets recorded later as well. The next document is the conservation easement deed, and I'm not going to go into a lot of details, but this is the thing that puts the easement on the property, that is the purchase of development rights, the tool by which that is done. It's a lot of paper. It's a very long legally binding agreement between the landowner, and the agency, the city. Here are a couple of generic pieces of language that are in a typical conservation deed. What governs a conservation easement are the conservation values, which are the things we're trying to protect. In most cases, the soil and sort of forest that's there, wetlands. And the permitted and prohibited uses are outlined in the easement as well. Those are some of the critical pieces of this. So what can they do and what can't they do? And those uses are checked against the conservation values. The gist is you don't want to do anything that harms the conservation values. And you do want to do everything to promote agriculture and natural restoration and management and all of those good things. The next document is a baseline documentation report. And this is another very long document that basically identifies the current conditions of the property so that as we monitor the easement going forward, we can refer to this baseline documentation and say, okay, nothing's changed or something has changed. So this is a current conditions map out of a baseline for a property. And so here we've identified all of the agricultural areas, different little natural areas, the riparian corridor, all of these things. So we could go back in the future and say, there was a forest there and now it's not there. You clear cut it, that's a violation of the easement. That's the bad side of it that hasn't happened. Or we can say, we see you're planting, alfalfa here. Oh, that's in the agricultural area, great. And so that's what that's for. And then the last step is closing. When all of those documents have been completed and agreed upon, we go to the title company and we close on the conservation easement. And that's the fun part. So that was a detailed look. Good, I still have some time to go through this part. So I will now talk about major projects, primarily one that we are working on for the next few months. That's sort of our focus for the next year. So three things that we're working on are prioritization. Prioritization is something that has been going on for the life of the Greenbelt. And that's just about making sure we're preserving the highest quality lands using various types of analyses, GIS mainly, and targeted outreach as appropriate. And as I sort of mentioned in another slide, we are improving tools that report on ecosystem services related to Greenbelt investments. So besides just saying we've preserved this many forests or this many acres of forest, this many wetlands, we want to be able to say, right, like carbon, this much carbon stored, carbon sequestered, pollutants prevented from going into the waterway, any other thing we want to work on, any other way we want to communicate that. So those two items were discussed at length in a community academy a year ago that the Greenbelt did. I'm going to focus on this third one. If you're really interested in learning more about those two, especially prioritization, I encourage you to go to that other recording. I want to talk more about the BioProtect cell model that we are pursuing, like all of our time, which is about utilizing an innovative acquisition structure to create affordable farmland purchase opportunities. So land is essential to a farm business, to any farm business, and one's farm is also often one's home as well. We are seeing a national trend in aging farmers and who are struggling to get their farmland to new farmers. And new farmers are struggling to be able to afford those farms. Farmland prices are high and they're having a hard time. New and beginning farmers are having a hard time acquiring land to work. We had this confirmed at a local level or a regional, Southeast Michigan regional level with a survey that was done last year, might have been 2021 at this point, but we are confident there are people here looking for farmland and not being able to get it. And particularly, these folks want to own their farmland. They don't want to be renting from someone who owns a lot of land. They want to own their own land. So how do we support that goal? How can we support affordable land access? Primarily, the way we are going to do that is through this buy, protect, sell method that private land trusts have been using for a while now, maybe a decade, and governments are finally jumping on board with this. There are also other organizations around the country that can help with certain financing, low interest loans. But how do we as a land acquisition based program help with that? And that's buy, protect, sell. So how do we support that affordable land access and also still accomplish our primary goal of land conservation? That's why we're going to use this method to do both of those things. In the traditional conservation easement process, we work with a landowner to buy the rights from their property, and that's it. One landowner, they own it the whole time. In Buy, Protect, Sell, an agency, the Greenbelt, purchase fee title to the farmland. Fee title is obtaining full ownership of the land, so we buy it outright. We reserve a conservation easement, and then sell the land back to another farmer who's looking for a farm. And recalling earlier how easement land value works, the easement reduces the purchase price of the land because it reduces its value. So that allows these new and beginning farmers to purchase this land at a lower price. The land is being conserved, and we can achieve which is the primary function of the Greenbelt, and we can achieve these additional economic and social outcomes by selling the land to a new and beginning farmer. So this is a work in progress, but staff, we are on our way. Staff built a framework for Buy, Protect, Sell last year, again, I think maybe 2021 at this point, or early 2022, that was reviewed by the Greenbelt Advisory Commission, as well as partner agencies. The framework talks about how to evaluate land to purchase and how to sell it via a public RFP process. That public push is really important to us. In early 2022, City Council approved our first pilot Buy, Protect, Sell parcel. And that's where this piece of land comes up again. So that I said to note earlier. So this land that we bought is just next to that Northfield Woods Preserve that the county just bought. So it's backing up to some nice woods here. But that outlined in red there is the farm we have bought and intend to sell via this Buy, Protect, Sell method. So our major workload right now is really fleshing out the details of the RFP and the proposal evaluation criteria. We are also looking to do more stakeholder engagement in the coming months about checking if we got the right idea with this whole program, which, you know, we think we did due to that survey that that showed us how many people are looking for this. And we would like feedback on how to measure a few of the land criteria we came up with for future Buy, Protect, Sell parcels. This was our first one. We're excited about it. And check out or keep an eye out for media pushes related to this in the next several months. So thank you. I will look at questions now. are there policies that prevent preserving Greenbelt land when there are opportunities for high density or affordable housing development? Who resolves conflicts in prioritizing land preservation versus building nearby affordable worker housing? That is a very complex question that we do discuss. So at a simple level, because we work in other, because the Greenbelt works in other municipalities, other townships, we sort of leave that question to them. If their zoning has said that they want it as agriculture, then that works for us. you know, we go by the zoning maps and by the future land use maps as well. That's what I'll say about that. But, you know, oh, Sarah has a comment? Or you just want me to answer this live? Sorry.
Oh, no, you're good. I'm just,
okay.
I'm just like moving them so that way you can see them better.
Oh, okay. Sorry. I've never done this type of question and answer before. So that's exciting. I think the city's goal, you know, as shown in its own zoning changes and we're updating the master plan, but in its zoning changes, you know, to upzone the main transportation corridors in the city, I think that's maybe where, you know, we're sort of trying to get the affordable worker housing. But the Greenbelt is really about, you know, getting the best land. So we have a scoring system that we work with, and if the land scores well in there, then it's considered good for our purposes. Is there a minimum size acreage that can be purchased via conservation easement? Good question. There is not a minimum size as written by any policy or ordinance. We will say about 25 acres as a nice minimum to hit, but that's not required. And that is only because it takes the same amount of work, the same amount of paperwork, the same amount of time to do a 10 acre conservation easement as it does a 150 acre easement. So there is no size. Size is a factor in the scoring system, though. Once you purchase an easement, does the Parks Department manage and maintain it? Probably not in the way that you're thinking. So it stays in private hands, and that farmer or that landowner maintains their own land. But an easement is monitored annually. So every single year, someone from the city, or right now we contract with someone to do this work, but someone goes out to each and every conservation easement land and walks around it and takes pictures and documents any changes that happened and checks if it's still meeting the requirements of the conservation easement. So it's monitored in that way, but not managed or maintained in any sort of like stewardship level. It's not like the forests are managed. Just the landowner does that if they want. Once an easement exists, are there guidelines about the type of farming that can be done or whether pesticides cannot be used? That's a great question. That was somewhat evaluated in the last strategic planning session for the Greenbelt, which happened in 2019. That question was asked of constituents, of attendees to that. People seemed to say that they were not ready to start prescribing that to farmers. We like to say that we are not farmers as staff, so we have a limited ability to tell farmers what's best for their land. So the extent of the guidelines of farming that can and can't be done is we prohibit new tiling of land. So if land is already tiled, it can be maintained, it can be retiled. If it hasn't been tiled, then it can't be. That's kind of about it. So no organic farming requirements or anything like that. We also have a good working relationship with Washtenaw County Conservation District, and they are moving people in that direction. So we can move people there for that use. With Biprotect Cell, are there restrictions about use of insecticides or other chemicals? Again, at the moment, no, but that is a, like I said, a program still being developed. So I'm happy to write that down as input. I would say the the goal, the main goal of that program is to ensure the success, or besides conserving the land, as we usually do, is to ensure the success of the farmer who buys it. So that could include these restrictions, or it might not. So we're still evaluating that. And how did I get into this as a career? That's a kind question. I have a bachelor's degree in wildlife ecology and a master's in urban planning. And I wanted to combine those two things. So I fell into parks. I worked for Washtenaw County Parks and Recreation Commission for the last 5 years, doing park planning and also land conservation. And I kind of learned it almost as an apprenticeship there. And now I'm still doing it. And it's fun and I like it. Thank you. And now I will hand it off to, thank you for your questions. I will now hand this off to Becky to talk about the Natural Areas Program.
Thank you, Rosie. And Rosie is going to drive my slides for me. So I appreciate that ahead of time, Rosie. Hi, everybody. My name is Becky Hand. I'm a stewardship specialist at Natural Area Preservation. And I'm going to talk all about who we are and what we do and why we are very cool. Next slide, please, Rosie. So we're part of the City of Ann Arbor's Parks and Rec Department, and we're funded by the voter-approved Parks Maintenance and Capital Improvements Millage. We were created in 1993, and our mission is to protect and restore Ann Arbor's natural areas and to foster an environmental ethic within the community. And our office is divided into three main sort of arms that all contribute towards these ecological restoration efforts that we're doing. We have our conservation crew, our outreach team, and our inventory team. And I'll talk a little bit about the difference between all of those teams in a second. Here we have just our organizational chart so you can see how we're all kind of laid out. Remy Long is our director. He's the deputy director within the Parks Department. So he's in charge of NAP and land acquisition. And then under Remy, we've got me, I'm a stewardship specialist. Tina Stevens is our volunteer and outreach coordinator. We have Mike Hahn, who's another stewardship specialist for two more days, and then he's leaving us. And then Rosie. So we all fall under Remy. I oversee two field biologists. Tina oversees 3 to 4 outreach assistants, and Mike oversees our conservation crew. That's about 5 to 7 people. And those, the folks that we all oversee are seasonal, part-time or full-time folks. So just to get into a little bit more detail about what we do in these different arms of NAP, our conservation crew, they are the folks that are out in the parks. They're doing the hands-on nitty-gritty work to remove invasive species oftentimes. And they're doing this in a lot of different ways, through hand pulling, through chainsaws, brush cutters, they're using herbicides occasionally, and the work that they're doing is prioritized throughout our parks. All of our park natural areas have been prioritized based on the quality of the habitat. So the higher quality habitats get the most attention because we want to keep our nice areas nice. And then as we kind of go down in quality, we're not always able to get to all of those places. So we've got so much area to cover. We've got 163 parks, and I think we're responsible for 1,200 acres. And so with a small crew of 5 to 7, it's hard to get everywhere. So we need to prioritize where we're going. So like I said, they are doing a lot of invasive species removal. They're trying to get those weedy species out of our habitats so we can have more room for native plants to thrive and better biodiversity of plants and animals in the parks. They're also doing prescribed burns out in the parks, and we just started our spring prescribed burn season. So you may hear on social media or see around that we're doing our burns. If you see smoke in the air, it might be us doing a burn out in a park. And those are pretty fun to see if you're ever out and about and you see us, come on by and see what it's all about. Can you go back, Rosie? Sorry. Thanks. Our crew is also maintaining and constructing trails is another thing they do. Like after the big ice storm and the snowstorm came by and a bunch of trees fell down, they've been out for days and days clearing trees that have fallen over trails. They're taking care of spots where trails are eroding and just making sure that our trails are accessible. They also are leading lots of volunteer work days and other stewardship activities, which I'm going to talk about a little bit more in a minute here. And they are collecting and processing native seeds in the fall when all of the grasses and the flowering plants are seeding. They'll go out, collect those seeds, clean them all up, make nice seed mixes so we can help spread those native species around throughout our parks. And they're also doing extra projects to sort of help us implement our stewardship plans in our natural areas. They may do things like surveying for different rare plant species or different animal species. They're basically just helping us see what's living and growing out in the park so that we can make the best management plans for our natural areas. All right, so that's our conservation crew. Then we have our outreach office, and these folks are busy. They are the ones that are kind of getting the word out about all the good work we do and coordinating with volunteers and getting different groups to come out and volunteer with us. We have a very robust park steward program, which is kind of a, like I call them our super volunteers. They are people that are really, really passionate about one park or a couple of parks, so much so that they want to just volunteer their time out there to do whatever they can to, you know, make those parks nicer. And it really does run a gamut of some people just like to walk the trails and pick up trash and just make sure that nothing seems out of place. And some people like to go out and pull garlic mustard all day and cut shrubs all day, and they are just happy working out in the park all day. So we partner up with these folks and we help them make independent plans so that they can go out whenever they have time, whenever they feel like it, and they can do the same sort of work that our field crew does, removing invasive species or just making sure that everything is in order out in the parks. So that's a big one of our programs that our outreach office runs. We also do volunteer stewardship work days, and these are days throughout the spring and fall. On the weekends, we do volunteer days where people can come out and do the same sort of work that our field crew does, the hand pulling of garlic mustard or cutting honeysuckle or buckthorn or other invasive plant species. We usually, once the spring gets rolling and the summer gets rolling, we have them every weekend, and sometimes we have multiple work days on a weekend. So we've got lots of people coming out that want to come out, especially now that it's getting nice out. People are ready to be out of their houses from being cooped up for the winter. So our outreach team is getting organized, getting school groups and church groups and sororities and fraternities that are looking for volunteer hours. Our outreach team is connecting them up, getting them set up with these work days. We also have a very cool opportunity, which is our volunteer burn crew. So anybody can actually volunteer to be on our prescribed burn crew with us. We do a training in the spring at the end of February. So we've already done one for this year. But once volunteers go through that training, then they can come out on a burn with us anytime. And you can pretty much do anything that our crew would normally do. You get to like light the actual fire. You can carry a water pack. And it's all up to the volunteer. We will take folks who say, I can carry a drip torch, but I can't carry a water pack. You know, we try to be accommodating for anybody who might like to volunteer with us. So that's a pretty unique opportunity. There's not a whole lot of places around where you can volunteer to do a prescribed burn out in a park. So our outreach team is getting that training rolling and getting those volunteers all set. We do our burns from the spring through the fall, but kind of during only through set months. So from about March to the beginning of May is our spring burn season. Then we have a little burn season in the summer, which is like August, September. And then we have another one from October to December, whenever the snow falls, and then we can't burn anymore. Our outreach team is also coordinating with folks that are looking for community service hours. We often get high school kids who are looking for community service, or like I mentioned, sororities who are looking for community service, getting those folks set up with special projects so that they can get their hours in. We also have people that come in and help us in our office with some of our communications and PR and doing things like posting our workdays on bulletin boards and fun stuff like that, helping us make flyers, helping us make buttons to hand out, all kinds of cool things. And then we also do a fair bit of community outreach. So we'll go to events like the Mayor's Green Fair or here on River Day, and we'll have a table where we'll sit and talk about what we do and recruit volunteers. Our outreach office helps organize us attending all of those events as well. We also do an Adopt a Median program where people can volunteer to basically adopt the little traffic island or little, you know, circles, traffic circles nearby where they live, and do things like mulching and planting flowers and weeding. That's a little bit of a smaller program, but we do run that program. And then we also help to run the Citizen Pruner program, which is in cooperation with the city's forestry department. So in this one, folks learn how to properly trim trees. And then in the wintertime, there's usually 4 or 5 work days where there are trees, street trees that may need trimming, and these volunteers will be trained on how to go out and trim these trees and maintain these trees. So our outreach team takes care of all of these different things. And even more on the next slide, thank you. As I mentioned, we have lots of communications that we do. We have a newsletter that we put out monthly. We also make an annual report at the end of the year. We have social media posts throughout the year. So just trying to get out the good word about what we're doing into the community and let people know how they can come and work with us if they want. We also have different events that we run, things like we partner with the Ann Arbor District Library to do informational nature walks. Those are, you know, just for fun. Kids and families can come out. We'll do a little walk through the woods. We do volunteer appreciation events every year. So anybody who's volunteered with us during the year can come out and we'll celebrate them and play some games and have some food. And it's always lots of fun. We coordinate also with Eagle Scouts who are looking for projects to do. We get lots of kids that want to build boardwalks and benches and all that fun stuff and make trails and things. So we'll help get them set with projects and kind of usher them through that process. And then we also do private stewardship work days. I mentioned earlier that we do the public ones that are like every weekend throughout the spring and summer. But we also have groups that want to do a work day just for themselves. So we'll also set up those private work days for Girl Scout troops and all kinds of different people. So our outreach team is also organizing those efforts. And we've got a ton of people who come out and volunteer with us. We have lots of pictures of happy volunteers here. Our staff at NAP is relatively small. There's only 12 to 15 of us. But every year we have about 2,000 volunteers that come out and work with us, and they contribute about 10,000 hours worth of work, which is pretty amazing. We would never be able to get to all of the places where we do work without the help of our volunteers. As I mentioned, we've got so much area to cover, we could just never do it if we didn't have all these awesome people volunteering with us. This graph just kind of shows the trend of our volunteer efforts over time. The orange bar is the number of volunteer hours in a given year, and the blue bars are the number of actual people. So you can see over time, we've kind of been going up and up and up. And of course, the pandemic put a little bit of a damper on things. I unfortunately don't have last year's numbers, but I think they're even higher than 2021. So we just keep going up and up with our volunteers, which is pretty awesome. All right, so I talked about our conservation crew and I talked about our outreach team. And now I'm going to talk about our inventory or our citizen science program. And this is the program that I oversee. So sorry, this presentation is weighted a little bit heavily on these programs. This program is for surveying the plants and animals that are out in our parks. Why are we doing this? Well, we're trying to enhance the wildlife habitat that we have in our parks. With our field crew, they're doing a lot of invasive species removal, as I mentioned, and they're trying to increase the diversity of plants, but we also want to keep the wildlife in mind as well as we're doing this work. We also do a little bit of education. So we do public bird walks and paddles down the river to look for turtles. just to kind of help teach folks in Ann Arbor about the very cool animals that we have in our area. Through the inventory program, I also coordinate student research that's going on in our parks. So with the universities all in town, I get lots of students that are looking for places to do research projects and looking for data and things like that. So if it's a research program going on in a park, it's oftentimes coming through me. And I also coordinate the city's geocaching permitting program. And if you've never heard of geocaching, it's a very cool thing where you take a GPS out into the woods, or nowadays you can use an app on your phone and it will guide you to a little hidden treasure in the woods. And once you find it, you can, it's usually like a little container. You can take a little treasure out of it and write your name in the logbook, like, hey, I found this on this day. So it's very cool. It's just a fun game. So I oversee where those are getting placed in our parks. And I also maintain all of the maps and the geographic information that we are keeping track of, things like our trails and the different ecosystems that are in our parks, where we've seen different butterflies and where we have different monitoring points. So all of that information I coordinate and oversee as part of this inventory program. All right, so just take a step back. What are we looking for in our inventory programs? Well, we're looking to see what plants we have in our parks. And as I kind of mentioned before, this helps inform how we prioritize where we do our work. So we are looking for, when we go out, we're looking to figure out as many plant species as we can identify in our different park areas. And the more species we have, the more diverse that habitat is, the higher the floristic quality is what we call it. So the floristic quality score helps us figure out, okay, this is a very high quality area. It has lots of different plants. It has rare plants. This is probably an area where we're going to focus with our field crew and make sure that we get those invasive plants out of there before they take over the ecosystem and the native plants are gone. We also have programs we're looking for birds. And then we've got frogs, toads, salamanders, and turtles, butterflies, and we're also monitoring change over time through photo monitoring. And I should mention that all of those bullets, except for the plants one, for all of those bullets, we also have volunteers working with us. So we've got two field biologists on staff who oversee different survey programs for these different cool animals. And they'll recruit volunteers and train them and teach them how to find what they need to find, and then turn them loose, assign them to parks and turn them loose, and people can report back what they're finding, which is pretty cool. Occasionally we have contractors, we hire contractors to do similar types of survey work, but 99% of the time it's our staff and volunteers who are doing these inventory programs. Next slide, please. So I'm going to go through each one just to kind of give you a little flavor of what these different programs are all about. All of these programs have a kickoff and training event in the spring where volunteers can tune in and they'll learn all about how to do these different surveys and how to identify the species that they're looking for. And identifying the species, we do that for some of our programs, but not all. Like for example, with our breeding bird survey, there are so many different bird species that we don't really train volunteers on how to, you know, recognize them. We kind of assume that people have some experience already coming in. So our breeding bird survey is actually coming up. If anyone watching is interested in birding and knows some birds, I think it's April 13th we have our training. And in this survey, volunteers go around to the parks and visit established monitoring points, and they'll stand at that point for 10 minutes and they'll just write down everything that they see and hear, all the birds that they see and hear. And then they'll also, as they're traveling around to their different monitoring points, they're also taking a list of just everything in general that they saw. And they'll submit it to us through an app called eBird. And then that data, we can use that data. I'll talk a little bit in a little bit about how we use the data. All right, so we also have our frog and toad survey. This training has already happened. But for this one and the salamander survey, which has also already happened, the training has already happened, We have recorded those. So if anyone is interested in getting involved, we can share the recordings with you. And my email address will be coming up towards the end of this presentation. So you can get a hold of me if you're interested. For the frog and toad survey, volunteers go out and they visit established monitoring points at night and they just listen for frog calls. And they'll record what species they hear calling and the amount of calling they hear. So do they just hear one frog or do they hear so many frogs they can't even tell how many frogs there are? For this one, we would train you on, there's maybe 6 or 8 different frog calls. So we would train you on how to identify each call so you know what you're hearing. But you go out at night on a rainy night sometimes is the best time and just go and listen for frogs and just record what you hear. For the salamander survey, it's a little bit similar. This is another one that happens most of the time at night, right about now. We're thinking that tonight is actually going to be the first good night for salamander weather. Salamanders hibernate under logs and kind of rocks and in the mud and stuff during the wintertime. And then in the spring, during the first warm, rainy night, they'll come out from their hibernating spots and they'll migrate to the closest, they're called vernal ponds. They're little pools in the woods that only last for, you know, the spring months and then they dry up. But in those ponds is where they lay their eggs and they do all their good stuff. So tonight we're thinking is gonna be the first night that they're all gonna kind of come out and start going down to the pond. So we've trained our volunteers on how to identify the, again, I think 5 or 6 species that we have. And they're gonna be going out tonight, walking around those ponds, looking for salamanders, rolling over logs, looking for salamanders, which you can also do during the day. So it doesn't always have to be at night. But you can see in the picture in the corner that was taken at night, our volunteer has a headlamp on and she found a salamander. So this is very exciting time for the salamander survey. Next, please. Thank you. We also have a butterfly survey. And this one we partner with the Michigan Butterfly Network, which is run from the Kalamazoo Nature Center. And in this survey, volunteers walk a set route in a park and they just record all the butterflies that they observe. So that rainbowy looking map is an example of a butterfly route. The different colored segments of the trail are different habitats that you would walk through. So you would walk through that red habitat and record your butterflies, then record your butterflies for the green habitat and just keep going. That's a good summertime one. Once the sun's out and it's warm, that's the best time for butterflies. And then we have a photo monitoring program, which is where volunteers visit established points in parks throughout the year, and they take a picture of the same view over time. And this helps us monitor how our restoration efforts are working. So in the example photos at the bottom there, one photo was taken in 2008 and the other one in 2017. And I know it's kind of hard to tell, but the 2008 photo, you can see kind of on the side and in the background, it's very brushy. This habitat is supposed to be a nice open prairie. But by 2017, you can see it's more open and you can see actually under the trees and you can see beyond. So this program just helps us keep track of how our work is actually working. How are we being successful in the field, I guess. Next slide, please. Great. So we collect all this information and then how do we use the results of what we get? So we're trying to establish goals for our different restoration activities. Sometimes folks find threatened, endangered, or special concern species. So if we know we have those, we want to try to enhance the habitat for those species to make it so that the population can expand. And we're also trying to figure out what are going to be the most appropriate restoration activities in a certain area. So just for example, some rare birds need a shrubby habitat to nest in. And if we've got a thicket full of invasive shrubs, but there's rare birds nesting in it, then we may decide to leave that thicket alone to keep the habitat for the rare birds so we can help support their population. Or to take the salamanders for an example, tonight, you know, they're out moving most likely. So when we know that the salamanders are out of hibernation and moving around, we will avoid doing any prescribed burns there because we don't want to burn up the salamanders while we know they're moving around. Can you go back? Thanks. The results of what people are sending in also helps us time our management activities. So like I mentioned with the burning and salamander migration, or it also applies to snakes. When snakes come out of hibernation and start moving around, we know we want to keep an eye out for those and not hit them with our fire if we can. But we also have some areas where we kind of give advice on the timing of mowing. So we have a couple of grasslands that the city owns. They're not parks, but they are home to rare bird populations. And those fields are occasionally mowed for hay, or for example, at the landfill, those grasses have to be mowed just for just to maintain the landfill. So we'll go out there, we'll make sure that before any mowing happens, that those rare grassland birds are done nesting and the babies have flown away. So there's no danger that they will be impacted by the mowing. All right, next slide, please. A little bit more about how we use the results from our surveys. So we're also helping to support the wildlife populations in that we have some artificial nesting habitat that we've constructed. So the picture on the bottom left is one of the canoe livery staff and one of our field biologists. Someone reported a turtle nest that was like right next to or in a trail. So that's not a great spot for a turtle nest. We don't want it to get trampled by people or dug up by skunks or raccoons or anything like that. So we went out and took a look, and there was indeed a nest there. If we find nests laid in inconvenient spots like that, or sometimes they'll nest in the wood chips in a playground or the sand in a volleyball court, we'll take the eggs out and then we'll put them. So the middle picture on the bottom is the eggs. And then the bottom right picture is once we've relocated the eggs, we've got these mounds made out of sand that we can put those eggs back into. And then we'll put a cover over top of them so they can't be dug up by skunks and raccoons. So these artificial habitats that we've made serve two purposes. One, a spot, they're a spot where a turtle can just be kind of lured right to, like, here is the perfect spot for you to make a nest. Or two, it's a good spot where we can relocate a nest if we need to. And we also have other kind of artificial nesting structures, like we have bluebird boxes all around the parks. The picture in the top right is us putting up an osprey nesting platform, trying to entice some osprey to build a nest. Unfortunately, we've since learned that they really like cell phone towers, so there's probably not very good chance that they'll use this platform, but at least we tried. Our hearts are in the right spot. and then we also have one spot where we've experimented with building a snake hibernaculum, which is a place where snakes will go and hibernate for the winter. Just a kind of a hole full of rocks and broken concrete and things that have lots of spaces where snakes can go down and hibernate in. So that's kind of a test thing. We'll see how that all goes. Next, please, Rosie. All right. So I've already kind of mentioned this, the results of the monitoring that folks are doing is helping us to see if our restoration efforts are working, or sometimes they're letting us know that we need to go back and revisit an area. Through our photo monitoring program, for example, sometimes we'll see a picture of a nice, clear, clean woods, and then maybe 2 years later, the view is getting covered up by honeysuckle that's growing up in the way. So it helps us know, oh boy, we should probably get back there and get that honeysuckle before it takes over. The example photos at the bottom are from Furstenberg Nature Area. The one from 1997 is just a total thicket of shrubs. And by 2022, those shrubs are completely and totally gone. You can see all the way to the river from this spot where the person was standing to take this picture. And I've scrutinized this back and forth, and I can assure you that this is the same area. And just if you're interested, we have all of our photo monitoring pictures up on a web map at a2gov.org/a2photomonitoring. So you can go around the map, you can click around the different points and see the pictures of how different places have changed over time. And the data that we're collecting, it's pretty cool that it has a global impact. So as I mentioned before, our breeding bird survey volunteers are submitting their data to an app called eBird, which is a site that's run by the Cornell Lab of Ornithology and the National Audubon. And the data that goes into eBird is being shared with educators, land managers, conservation biologists, researchers, so that it's the information is not just coming to us and staying there, but it's available to the wider scientific community. Similar with the Michigan Herp Atlas, which is a project of the Michigan Department of Natural Resources. They're keeping track of all of the reptiles and amphibians. Herps is a short term for reptiles and amphibians. So we submit our data to them every year so that they can have like a statewide record of what those populations are looking like all over the state. And as I mentioned, we partner with the Kalamazoo Nature Center for our butterfly survey. And all of our information for that butterfly survey goes into another one of those national databases. It's called Pollard Base. And that's another one where researchers and land managers can access that information and use it to see how butterfly populations are changing and use and see if that is an indicator of the different of ecosystem quality changing or other environmental factors changing, because butterflies are a pretty sensitive indicator species when there is an environmental change. So this is all to say that a lot of the information that comes into us, it helps us manage our own land, but then it's also serving this wider purpose as it's available to more and more people. And that was all that I had. I've got my email address there if anyone would like to get a hold of me with any questions, and Rosie's email address is there as well. So I will see what questions come in. All right, I hate buckthorn. Yes, me too. Is it okay to tear off branches of this nasty invasive species in Ann Arbor parklands? I do it when they grow into paths. I hope it doesn't violate any rules. No, that does not violate any rules. If you want to tear off buckthorn branches, we are happy for you to do that. Just tearing off a branch probably isn't going to kill the whole plant, but if you're just trying to break them off so they're not in the way of people coming by, that's totally fine. All right, that was the only question. So if anyone else has questions, I'm happy to answer more, or you're welcome to email me anytime. We got one. All right. When the turtle nests get moved, does anything happen with the adult turtles? That's a great question too. When turtles lay eggs, they just lay them and go. They never come back. They don't take care of them like birds do. So once the adult is done, they move on and they don't ever come back. So nothing will happen with the adult turtles. Sometimes people will come upon a turtle while it's in the middle of laying a nest, and turtles do this thing where they freeze. Like instead of us having like a fight or flight, the turtle will just freeze. It can't move until it's basically done doing its thing. So we'll occasionally get people calling us and saying, there's a turtle laying a nest right now. So sometimes we're able to get out there, kind of like do crowd control, keep that turtle safe until it's done doing its thing. And then if we need to move the eggs, we'll move them. We try not to as much as we can because we don't want to disturb them, but also we don't want them to get trampled or, you know, dug up by a dog or anything like that. So, thanks for the compliment on my posters. I appreciate that. All right. That looks like that was it.
Thank you both so, so much for all of that. That you guys do such great work. I love every single person in that department. Remy is such a great boss. I'm so happy that he was able to, that just all your team is so awesome. I'm very, very grateful for you both to be here today. And thank you for answering all the questions. If you need to get a hold of them, you saw their emails, and their emails are also attached in the schedule section of the A2CA. And that's all that we got today. So thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Sarah, for organizing. Thank you, everybody who came and asked questions.
Of course. All righty. Everybody have a great night.
Thanks, you too.